everyone. Thanks for joining us today. We are so excited to be here and discuss some of our latest innovations that are enabling sustainable transformation to the Microsoft cloud. My name is Oniel Lucrisia. I am today's moderator, and I will be asking questions to our experts in the room. We'd love for you to walk away with a foundational understanding of the work that we are doing in our data centers, our cloud, and beyond to reduce our environmental impact across the globe. I am so thrilled to have Microsoft Cloud sustainability leaders and experts, Christian Belady, Patrik Öhlund, and Anand Narasimhan, join us to share more about what these developments mean for Microsoft and beyond. These panelists have deep and diverse industry knowledge across areas such as Azure data center development, supply chain, and energy, all at the heart of our innovation that is transforming the work we do and encouraging us to do more with less. Before we jump into these questions, I'd like to quickly level set on where we are today as a company. Today, the Microsoft Cloud is helping customers reduce their carbon footprint and meet their own environmental goals. The cloud is currently up to 93% more energy efficient and up to 98% more carbon efficient than on-premises solutions. Furthermore, we've made incredible progress in innovating our sustainability practices. Microsoft commits to being carbon negative, water positive, zero waste, and to protect more land by 2030. With these commitments in mind, I'll kick us off with this question. Christian, let's start with you. It's no surprise that your team is at the forefront of developing breakthrough ecosystem technologies. What sustainability investments are you leading today at Microsoft, and how do these investments ladder up to our current commitments?
Yeah, thanks, Oniel. Thanks, Oniel. I had my headset on mute. So my team, really everything we work on accrues to sustainability. We focus primarily on breakthrough tech and ecosystems revolving around the data centers. We do work anywhere from advanced cooling technology. You may have seen some of the stuff we work on around immersion cooling, which allows us to operate at much higher temperatures and thus allowing us to use less water or eliminate the need for evaporation of water for cooling. Work in networking as well. Primarily focusing on free space optics technology to see what we can do to eliminate the miles and miles of fiber that we have in our data centers, and also look at how we integrate with nature. So I have a biologist on staff as well. And all of this builds up to kind of looking at the data center of the future. Primarily, when we look at the data center of the future, it's really looking at how we should do things if we started with a clean slate, and what would the data center look like, 10 years from now. Almost everything we work on is 5 to 10 years out. One of those areas is, of course, generation and storage of energy. A lot of work around hydrogen. Our fuel cell we just announced was 3 megawatt hydrogen fuel cell, the first of its kind at that scale, to see if we could even use fuel cells for backup generation, and it appears we can. Now, of course, there's a lot of work that has to be done. The hydrogen supply chain is still in its infancy, and so that's an area we work on as well. But all of these things, like I said earlier, will ultimately accrue to how do we make the data center of the future be much more integrated with nature, and in the end of the day, be sustainable with zero carbon, hopefully, embodied carbon in the ecosystem.
And jumping over to Patrik, can you share more about sustainable innovations within the energy ecosystem?
Yeah, sure, absolutely. So in my daily job, I'm leading the energy team for Microsoft Cloud in the EMEA region. And in this work, I have the opportunity to work on a lot of interesting stuff. As you know, energy and sustainability is really strongly intertwined, and energy is very much about reducing carbon emissions also. So I wanted to take this opportunity to talk about two very interesting and, in my opinion, groundbreaking projects that we have launched just in the past year. One is the grid interactive UPSs in Ireland that we recently announced, the work that we're doing there. The other one is a large-scale heat reuse project in Finland. When it comes to grid interactive UPSs, just quickly explain why do we need this? Because I think as Microsoft, we are strongly committed to help decarbonize the energy system. And a part of decarbonization is really to bring more renewable energy sources online, wind and solar and so on. The problem with this type of generation assets is that they are more intermittent and they don't have as much rotating mass. This means that they cause more frequency disturbances on the grid. And the really interesting part here is that we have assets in our data centers. We have a type of batteries that we call UPSs, and these batteries are perfectly suited to help support the grid and control the frequency on the grid. So by using these existing batteries that we have and connect them to the grid and receive signals from the grid operator, we can then help stabilize the grid as we get more and more wind and solar online. So we are in a new and innovative way, we're using our existing assets to provide these types of services back to the grid and help support more renewable. The other project that I mentioned, the large-scale heat reuse in Finland, is actually, as far as I know, it is the largest project of its kind in the world. And it's quite interesting because then again, why are we doing it in the first place? All data centers, and not just ours, but all data centers generate heat. And at the same time, we are, especially in Europe these days, with everything going on, we are looking for new options, new sources of heat for heating homes and houses and so on. So what we are doing is that we are planning to install heat exchangers in our data centers. It's, from a technical point of view, fairly simple system. We are using heat exchangers. We are transferring low temperature heat to our partner, Fortum, in that case. And they are then using electrical heat pumps and using this heat to transfer and heat homes in Finland. Once this system is fully in operation, we will be able to heat supply heat for up to 40% of the need of heat in Finland's second largest city. What is also interesting here from a sustainability point of view is that by doing this, we will help our partner Fortum to dismantle an existing coal-fired heat plant that they are currently using for heat production. This will actually reduce carbon emissions in Finland with about 400,000 tons carbon per year. So it's quite substantial. And I think you see a common theme between these two projects. They are very different in nature from a technical point of view, but they have in common that they are, it's kind of a circular approach, and we are using our data centers to bring something back to society and through the and to the energy ecosystem. So two quite recent and interesting projects.
Thank you so much, Patrik. Anand, what sustainable projects at Microsoft are you working on to drive sustainable supply chain transformation?
Thank you, Anil, and Patrik and Christian, great to talk to you as well. So Christian spoke about the future of data centers. Patrik talked about this massive renewable energy transformation. Our work is primarily on something very foundational. It's the supply chain that powers Microsoft Cloud. And our goals in relation to what you described at the start of this session is to reduce our emissions by about half, a little more than half, between now and 2030, and to help our cloud get to zero waste as well, along with getting to water positive and to work with ecosystems. So a very big part of our focus is to figure out how to make this really big transformation across our entire supply chain. And it starts with design. So the design of all of the hardware that goes into our data centers, components, servers, et cetera, how do we think about future generations, generation over generation, improvements in emissions intensity, reduction in waste? So if you start with the design side and then you move into this transformation of the supply chain, how do you get all our suppliers to become more sustainable, to get their reduction roadmaps aligned with ours, to help them transform business models to become more sustainable? And the last part of our work, our strategy, is really around how to make all this more circular. So when things come out of our data centers, what do we do with them? How do you optimize across sustainability, compliance, and financial value? Of course, all of this, when cloud is growing, you're trying to introduce something that is new and different, and sustainability needs to get embedded into pretty much every part of the supply chain, all the way through to recycling and to increasingly circular outcomes. So that's the space that we're in. An area that is a little different for us, but something that I think is unique and sets us apart, is this: that a few years ago, when we started on this journey, we told ourselves that everything we do for ourselves, we would also do for our customers. So the methodologies, the platforms, every innovation we come up with, we're very focused on trying them out for ourselves, proving that we can use them in Microsoft Cloud. And then we'd like to build them into platforms so that our product teams and our solution teams can use them to enable our customers on their own sustainability journey. So that's very broadly what we do. Some interesting innovations in the last couple of years, we've talked quite a bit about our circular centers, essentially a way for us to look at what happens to every component that is in Microsoft Cloud, every component and every server from the beginning of its life in the cloud should have one of several outcomes at its end of life several years down the road that optimizes across all of our key drivers around value and compliance and sustainability and security and risk, of course. So as you do this, every data center, every large data center campus now has the ability to determine what should happen to every component so that you can maximize sustainable and circular outcomes. So that is something we're very pleased with. It is rolling out now across our footprint. So over the course of the next year or so, we should have coverage across the world to intercept every component that comes out of our data centers and to find ways to maximize circular outcomes. Another area that we're very pleased with is the platform work that we do. So in recent times, and even now at Ignite, you'll be hearing about Cloud for Sustainability, the Emissions Impact Dashboard, investments that have allowed us to bring sustainability insights to customers. Some of the foundational building blocks for those are built within our group to help our product teams, our solution teams, to take all of these insights so that customers can help themselves as they figure out how to transform their own businesses and their own supply chains. So I'll hand it back to you, Oniel.
So I think if I may comment on Oniel, I think Anand is having maybe the toughest job of all of us because he's addressing scope 3 emissions. I think it's worth mentioning that we as Microsoft and our objective to become carbon negative, that is really across all three emission scopes. And I think Christian and I, we are spending a lot of our time on scope 1 and scope 2 emissions. Anand and the work on supply chain is really, really challenging, and it will address our scope 3 emissions. So keep up the good work, Anand.
Thank you, Patrik. You're right. Scope 3 is challenging for a number of reasons, right? There's a lack of methodologies generally. Supply chains traditionally have not focused on sustainability in general. So you're trying to embed a very new concept into very mature supply chains. And it's challenging to do that, especially in businesses that are growing and scaling. And at the same time, you're trying to introduce a very fundamental aspect that has to be embedded into every aspect of every value chain, not just within Microsoft, but across the entire supply chain. So it is complex, but it is sort of an existential thing. We have to do it. It is important, but there's a lot of value and a lot of opportunity in it as well.
Thank you so much, Anand. I'm super fascinated by all the inspiring work that's being done here and certainly the impact that this has on progress against our commitments. I know you have all shared about your work within Microsoft and your role in the company. And Anand, you touched a bit on the entire ecosystem, including cloud technology and other key industries. But can you tell me more about sustainable contributions and projects beyond Microsoft? How were you able to evolve your current work into this broader landscape? And Christian, I'll start with you.
Yeah, so I think that Anand finished with the right thing, and that is looking at what we can do beyond just our own walls within Microsoft. We have some great sustainability targets where we have great programs to hit them, but we really have to look beyond our walls. And there's a lot of industry work like OCP, iMasons, more recently I've been involved with, where it's an industry collaboration of now it's about 170 companies that are committing to drive standardization in carbon accounting. So it plays right into what Anand was talking about earlier around the supply chain, because at the end of the day, we can only be as good as our supply chain. And so the iMasons organization has started something called the iMasons Climate Accord. 170 companies have committed to driving the standardization, where it's going to start with all products, all data centers, having a QR code label that you can actually see where all the carbon is in that data center, in that product, whatever the case might be. So there's a lot of great work happening across the board. And at the end of the day, without the proper carbon accounting, we can't really come up with where we are in our data centers. And so I think there's a lot of great work happening there.
So I can add to that, beyond these consortiums that are coming together, I want to recognize that our work, at least in Microsoft Cloud, is fundamentally one end of a very complex semiconductor supply chain. And the semiconductor industry traditionally has not done much about sustainability. So fortunately, the industry is starting to come together. You are starting to see consortiums forming to focus on things like methodologies and shared investments and moving to renewable energy, for example, within their manufacturing processes. So a lot of that work, it will take time, of course, but this is really where I feel Microsoft can add value. We do run a very large and complex supply chain, and our data center footprint is growing. So we do have some abilities to help that entire environment to think about methodologies, think about policy, to think about how various aspects of the supply chain can transform and make change. So all the lessons we've learned that we'll continue to learn over time, we're happy to share. We are partnering with several organizations, as Christian mentioned, some that will be announced in the near future as well, with COP27 coming around as well. All of them essentially helping to channel our efforts as an industry to move towards more sustainable business models.
Great. Patrick, anything you want to add?
Yeah, I can mention a few things. Similar to Christian, I've also been engaged in iMasons. I founded the sustainability committee in iMasons a few years ago. I am no longer the chair of the committee, but I think that the work we started to focus on in that committee was really to inspire and trigger people of the organization to help develop solutions and ideas around carbon emissions. And we did develop a new industry-wide framework for sustainability, including a shared vision at the time. So I think also at my work at Microsoft, I think what I'm trying to do on a personal level and what we are doing as a company is what has been said already. We are really focusing on trying to tell our story, to tell others what we're doing, to challenge others. Of course, it's kind of a friendly competition, but also to inspire and help other people to come up with new ideas. Because I think it's really our responsibility, being the kind of market leaders as we are. We we owe society to help inspire others and challenge others. One example we did in my team a few years ago, we had in terms of energy procurement, we set up a new commercial solution in Sweden together with our partner Vattenfall for 24/7 matching of renewable energy. And this was at the time that the first commercial solution available. And I think what has happened since then is that other companies have followed the 24/7 matching approach. So I think by doing things like this, telling the story, sharing, collaborating, I think that is what we need to do if we want to accelerate decarbonization, sharing all the good practices, and maybe also sharing when our failures, when things go wrong, we should share that too and let people know that, learning also from our mistakes.
Yeah. Patrik, I just want to add something that that triggered a thought in what you said. When you think about energy and the transformations you're talking about, it also brings up this area of how we, as we transform the hardware supply chain, we're also looking at all of the software layers on top, from our services, platforms, solutions, all the way to customers, and how every one of those layers can embed sustainability as well. So from developing green software through the fabric that connects the software layers to the hardware below, there's a lot that we can do to achieve some of the things that you just mentioned in terms of time shifting, geography, and so on, to get the best outcomes for optimizing the use of renewable energy across our data center footprint. It's very intimately connected to the hardware. It's an area where we realize that the hardware infrastructure world has been so decoupled from the software side of the industry that we have to make those connections much stronger to squeeze the best value out from a sustainability perspective. So it's something that we are thinking about very actively, and I feel over the next few years is going to become a very interesting and important part of our focus.
Yeah, and I think that's a great point. And I think you also mentioned the Microsoft Cloud for Sustainability earlier. And I mean, that is really in line with our core mission, right? To empower every person on the planet to achieve more. So, I mean, we can do only so much in terms of our own direct impact. And we are really trying to do that, as we mentioned, across all three scopes. We are hoping that maybe the biggest impact we can have is to help support our customers that using our cloud services to track and analyze their carbon emissions and also giving them the right tools to help decarbonize their businesses.
I think that makes for a good segue to our last question. I'd love to wrap up by giving some advice to other organizations and folks in the audience. What advice can you give to challenge old ways of working and raise the bar for folks to think more sustainably?
Patrik, would you like to go first? I think we might have lost Christian for a minute there.
Yeah, let's hope he comes back. But no, I can go first. And I think I've said some of this already. I think number one is really to dare to try new things and to stick out your neck and challenge existing paradigms and all truths. In the two examples that I mentioned, if I'm being very honest and forthcoming, for waste heat reuse, for instance, when we started the project I referred to earlier, we had a lot of questions and comments and concerns that no, it can't be done because our the heat from our data centers is so low temperature and so on. It will not work. But it turned out that we were very much able to find a way to get it to work eventually. So I think we have to challenge existing paradigms. And the same goes for the grid interactive UPSs, that we have to some extent connect these UPSs to the outside world to be able to receive signals from the aggregator to control this. And the reactions we had from some people was, no, we can't do that. That's not safe. And it turned out that our very skilled and talented people, they could find a way to make it work in a safe way. So I think that goes hand in hand with the next sort of advice from my side is really if you have colleagues and maybe staff members, member of your team and so on that are, they want to try out new things, try to encourage that, give them sort of the space so that they can try out the new things and grow. And I think the final advice from my side would be to, when you do mistakes, because you will do mistakes, you will fail, that's fine, as long as you learn from them and maybe also share that with others and so that you don't repeat them. And you're on mute, Oniel. We need to have that comment in every Teams call.
Great advice. Anand, do you want to continue with any other pieces of advice?
Yeah, absolutely. Sure. Patrik, I think you're right in saying there's a paradigm shift underway. We are looking at very significant transformations across all of our value chains, supply chains everywhere. These are not easy problems to solve. They're very, very difficult. As I mentioned, we're trying to make all these transformations in the midst of growth and scale across many of our industries. And so we have to come up with the right ways to measure, the right ways to really understand where we are today and how we're going to measure progress as an entire ecosystem, not just as one company or one industry, because everything is so connected. Even with the semiconductor industry, it's so pervasive. It's literally across every industry that you think about. And some of these changes have to involve literally everybody up the supply chain and down the supply chain. It's the entire life cycle. So don't want to give advice necessarily, but I will speak from our own experience that it requires a lot of strategic thinking and planning. This is for the long run. This is not a short-term play at all. It's going to take many years, and it's also not going to end at 2030 or 2040 or wherever we've set our goals. This is the way businesses need to perform in the future. Sustainability must be at the core of everything we do. At Microsoft, Satya announced several weeks ago that sustainability is now one of our fundamental pillars. And I think it's important to recognize that. And then everybody across the company and across every industry can then focus on embedding sustainability everywhere. It's going to take a collective effort. It's something where we need to be extremely transparent across industries and to share learnings, good or bad, and to move us collectively forward. Yeah.
Thank you, Anand. Now that Christian is back, I'd like to close with this question for Christian. What other aspirations do you have for the future? How will your projects continue to progress? I know you've touched on the ecosystem already, but I'd love to just hear more about, you know, what you expect the next 5 years to look like.
Wow, you know, I wish I could predict the future, but I do believe in the next 5 years, we're gonna see much more collaboration. Certainly we all have our own company goals, our sustainability goals, but at the end of the day, I think it's really going to boil down to how we could move as a much bigger force, how we all come together. I always say 1 + 1 = 10. We all need to work together, think bigger and broader, and look at how can we solve the problem together. Because if Microsoft meets its sustainability goals, it really doesn't make a difference in the grand scheme of things. However, if Microsoft, in collaboration with all of the companies in the industry, meet their goals and then even have industry-wide goals, that's when big change happens. And so I think I was just on a industry call earlier, and that's what we were talking about, is that the next decade is going to be on how we collaborate together across companies, not just within companies. And I think that's going to be a big deal. And that's really where I'm spending a lot of my time now.
Thank you, Christian. Well, thank you all for this compelling discussion on some of the latest innovations and things that we are working on to create a more sustainable future. I'm inspired. I hope you're inspired. I hope this session gave you a taste of what's to come. We have a lot to look forward to and see how these developments continue to scale. For the audience, I wish I had more time for questions, but I will continue to respond to the chat, and then I'll throw some helpful resources in there for you to look at. Hope you enjoy the rest of your Ignite. Have a good day, everyone.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Bye.